Welcome to Connie Martinson Talks Books. The girls on the cover, they were like shooting stars. They came across and then they were gone. They were the queens of noise. The real story of the Runaways by my guest Evelyn McDonald, and it's published by DeCapo Press. Welcome, Evelyn.
Thank you, Connie. It's great to be here.
And they were like shooting stars.
They were. They lasted not even 4 years from the day they first got together in a rec room in Huntington Beach and jammed Joan Jett and Sandy West until they broke up the last show in San Francisco.
And Sandy had come all the way from way in the valley. For anyone who knows Los Angeles, that's way in the valley, to meet with Joni in Huntington Beach.
Actually, it was the other way around. Oh. Joan came from the valley, from Canoga Park, and took, she says, multiple buses to see Sandy in Huntington Beach. And all five members that eventually became the Runaways were from different corners of this sprawling metropolis we live in here.
And the person who really was, he wasn't Svengali, but he sure controlled the five women, a man named Kim Fowley.
Right. Kim Fowley, to give Kim credit where credit is due, it was his idea for there to be an all-girl group that played this hard, aggressive music, not necessarily a bubblegum group or a vocal group, but a group of hard rock teenagers. And he found these five young girls, they were teenagers, and he put them together. He also was probably not the best father figure that some of them needed. Yeah, to say the least.
Yeah. And they lived, I mean, he had sort of the raunchy apartment where everybody would like crash. And it was a matter of he really had a whip, a mental whip over them.
Right, absolutely. Well, he had spent a little bit of time in the military, so he treated them like a drill sergeant, or like a really tough coach. And he put them through routines. He lived in Hollywood. He was the son of, he says like D-minus actors, movie actors, as he jokes. So he was very much part of the strange world of show business that we have here.
In the end of the five of them being together, it was Lita on guitar, Cherry was a singer, Jackie was, Fox was on bass, and bass players in this group always had a problem.
Yes, they went through a few bass players.
And Joni Jett was, what was her strength?
She played rhythm guitar, and she co-wrote a lot of the songs, and she eventually became the lead vocalist. She always shared the vocals with Cherie Curry, but when Cherie left the band, Joan became the primary.
And Sandy West was?
The drummer.
And she drummed like a man.
She had strong muscles, and she hit those drums hard, and her love, her favorite music was hard rock and heavy metal, and she wanted to play like that. She was not a big woman, a petite girl, but muscled. And
it was also an era, as you point out, where girls had come into their own. It was Title IX, that schools now had to give them equal time and money.
Right.
And these were almost the products also of the best generation?
Right. Well, these were girls who were raised to believe they could do whatever. They could be president, they could be astronaut, which are two things that Joan thought about being before she became a rock star. They thought, you know, they were playing football and soccer at school. Yeah. They had to fought to get into the school band, because actually that was pre-Title IX for Sandy. So they were raised with a sense of so they could do whatever guys do.
But they weren't raised with playing classical music first and then going into rock. It was a matter of, I feel it, I do it.
They were true rock and roll lovers, especially Joan. Really, really all of them were really rock and roll fans. They weren't gonna, Sandy's family wanted her to play violin, play a stringed instrument, because they had three other girls, so they wanted to have a string quartet in the band. But Sandy was like, no, I want to play the drums.
And Sherry, she had a twin, and she wanted no part of being a twin, really.
Well, she loved her sister Marie very much. I'm sure she still loves her sister Marie very much. But I think it was important for her to step out on her own and do her own thing. But actually, it was conflict between her commitment to her family and her commitment to the band that did ultimately lead her to leave the band. So in a sense, she did choose her twin and her family ultimately.
This sociologically, too, was the era in Los Angeles where Sunset Strip was the Mecca.
Right.
Whiskey a Go Go started, and to be able to play there was Valhalla.
Right. And in the time that the brief time that the Runaways were together, they really were queens of that Sunset Strip scene. I mean, they were just one of the hottest bands in Los Angeles. And Joan lived across from the Whiskey a Go Go, and her apartment was party house for a lot of the bands.
But you point out in the book, they did not get great reviews when they first started.
Well, they got mixed reviews when they first started. They got some very positive reviews, but then there began to be a real backlash against them, and there was a lot of, there's a lot of, let's put it on the line. There was a lot of sexism in the reviews. There was a lot of, oh, they can't play their instrument. Oh, they're too sexy. Critics didn't take them seriously.
And because also it was an era of indigenous sex, I suppose, where one says, are you bi, are you straight, what are you?
Right, there was a lot of experimentation, and I would say maybe trying on different roles, seeing who you liked to be with, and coming out of the glam music scene. I mean, David Bowie was doing that, Elton John was doing that, and the Runaways did that a little bit.
Yeah, and the other part was that they would, who was going to be my roommate on the road?
Yes. So, and there were all kind of different allegiances within the band, and those allegiances shifted. People would have fights. I mean, these are five teenage girls in full hormonal flush out on the road on their own, and sometimes not really great conditions with not great people around them.
Mercury was their record.
Their label, yep.
And Mercury made a very good deal for Mercury.
Yes, yeah, and a very good deal for Kim Fowley. And maybe not such a great deal for the Runaways, but they did give them money, and they gave them tour support for the first time they went on the road, which they went all across the United States, and they went to England. They didn't give them tour support after that. They sort of trotted the band out, didn't do so well, and they very quickly lost interest in the group.
And as the group was forming, because they were minors, the parents had to come in and sign the contracts. And most of them did not know what a contract should have.
No, they, even though they were living in Los Angeles, and you would have thought maybe they would have had better access to entertainment lawyers, they used a family lawyer who did not know entertainment law. And their contract is actually the contract that they signed with Kim Fowley is just an amazing document. It should go up on the Smoking Gun website. It's hilarious.
Yeah, including that no matter what they did, he owned the Runaways.
He owned the name, the Runaways. At one point, he even argued that he owned the name Joan Jett and that he owned the name Sandy West because these were stage names and he claimed their trademark. Now, he didn't win that in any way, but he tried.
Their big success, oddly enough, was not the United States. It was Japan.
Japan, they were huge. Japan, the Japanese to this day love rock and roll that's very theatrical, that's very catchy, and they got the Runaways. They had loved the Beatles, they'd loved Susie Quattro, who was sort of a forerunner to these girl rockers, and they just really identified, or maybe not identified, but just saw them as superheroes almost on stage with their costumes and their real strength. When the Runaways performed, they really exuded
Because
power.
they had been, I guess in Sweden and in England, they had been like attacked by mobs. They got
Right.
to Japan, and there were the schoolgirls dressed in their little uniforms and so really polite to them.
Right. Screaming, doing the kind of Beatlemania screaming thing, but not trying to harm them. And it's interesting because in Japan, they seemed to appeal to the women more than, whereas in England or I think in Europe in particular, their audience tended to be more male and maybe more aggressive to them.
What were they like on the road?
They, you know, it was the 1970s. They were a rock and roll band. They were teenage girls. They had some fun on the road. They, you know, they had some pranks they would pull. They had a one of their roadie slash road managers was a big prankster. So there was a lot of crazy Spinal Tap kind of.
What was interesting was that they did not have enough money to really get into drugs.
Right.
Yeah.
And, you know, there's a movie that came out a few years ago called The Runaways that's based on Cherie Currie's memoir of being in the band, which is a great movie. I love it. It does sort of play up the drug use among the members, which was definitely there, and they were definitely underage. And some of them, for some of them, the drugs really became a problem. But, you know, I think the movie overplays that a little bit. I mean, that's kind of a typical rock and roll narrative. So.
But the fact you said, they didn't have the money. When you look at how, well, it ended up they each made $1,000 a week.
Maybe.
Because they were responsible for having their rooms, their cars, their everything.
Right.
But Mercury wanted the money back.
Right. So this is what one of the things that happens with recording artists, they get a record advance. It actually happens with book publishers too, but with writers too, but it's publishing industry is a lot better than the music industry. So you get an advance against recording your album, and the record company pays for tour promotion and stuff, but they take that money back from all the royalties. So you may have all this stuff paid for, but then it's all coming out of the money you're making off the album, which in their case, they did not make a lot of money off of their records in
How
the United
did you
States.
Happen to become both a writer on music and this period, as well as the book?
I have written about music since I was in high school. I, you know, to quote Joan Jett, quoting the Arrows, I love rock and roll. And actually, I can remember as a teenager when that song was a hit, and I just loving seeing a woman singing that. And so I've written about music for a really long time.
Were you a singer as well?
No. I know how to play guitar. I actually own the same guitar that Joan plays in the movie, but I never play it, so I can't say I'm a guitar player.
Uh-huh.
I just loved music, and I've always loved to write. So I've actually written a few books. So,
What were the other books, by the way?
My first book, which celebrates its 20th anniversary in a year, was called Rock, She Wrote, and it was a collection of women writing about music. And we actually had two pieces on the Runaways in that book.
Yeah.
So there's a way in which, you know, there's a trail back to my previous work.
When did they start falling apart? Was that the second trip to Japan?
Well, they only went to Japan once. They went to Europe a couple of times. Mm-hmm. But they were supposed to go back to Japan. But after the infamous Japan tour, after the band had been together about 2 years, during the tour, Jackie Fox, the bass player, actually quit the band while they were still in Japan in a pretty horrible, tragic incident, was very upset and left the band. And shortly thereafter, Cherie Currie left. So that was the first falling apart, but they regrouped. They put Joan out front, which is maybe what they should have done from the beginning. And they became a four-piece. And I actually think that they were really strong in that period, and the interplay between Joan and Lita as guitar players is just amazing. So, and then they were together as the four piece. But by that point, because they'd lost the cute blonde front singer, the record company lost interest in the band. They separated from Kim Fowley, and they really tried to keep it going, but they just weren't having success. Drugs did become a problem. Members of the band weren't getting along, and it did fall apart.
I'm holding up this group of pictures. Tell me about some of the people.
Okay, so on the top left, we see an infamous photograph from Cream magazine of the girls lying on the beach giving photographer, The Finger. That's the Fabulous Five. That's the lineup with Cherie and Jackie. And then you have Jackie on Kim Fowley in a rather provocative pose. You have Cherie in her infamous corset or bustier that she would wear during the song Cherry Bomb on stage, mm-hmm. which was her signature tune. And then you have Joan Jett below Cherie, just great picture by Brad Elterman. And then next to her, you have Sandy West on the drums, and above them is Jackie Fox. So,
yeah, tell me about Blue, Victoria.
Victoria Blue, A.K.A. Vicky Blue, Victoria Tischler Blue. After Jackie left the band, she was brought in as the bass player. She had not played bass before playing in the Runaways. She was a guitarist, which was actually the same with Jackie. Jackie was originally a guitarist, but she learned to play the bass, and she was in the band for about a year, toured mm-hmm. with them, toured North America with the Ramones and as co-headliners, and they went back to Europe with Vicky in the band. I think they played Europe twice with Vicky in the band.
Yeah.
But she never actually really got on a record. The record they recorded while she was in the band, she was out of the band by that point. She's on the pictured on it, but she plays on maybe one song.
Mm-hmm. So the people who really created the music was Joan Jett and Lita.
Well, yeah. You know, they all contributed to songwriting. Mm-hmm. Every one of them co-wrote some of the songs. Joan was the main co-writer and Kim Fowley wrote a lot of the songs mm-hmm. with them. But Sandy wrote some good songs, and Lita wrote mm-hmm. some good songs. They all contributed to the songwriting.
And how many years in between?
About 30 years, yeah. So, and this is, on the top is Sandy and Vicky. So Vicky Blue made a movie called Edge Play. That's a documentary about the band. And then on the bottom is Joan and Cherie flanking Kristen Stewart and Dakota Fanning, which is at the premiere of the other movie about the Runaways, which is called The Runaways.
Interesting how they survived.
Yes, all of them survived being in the band, and all of them survived being out of the band for a while. Sandy West did pass
away
of cancer.
Yeah. Yes. But there was also the one who went to Harvard Law School.
Jackie Fox went to Harvard Law School with the same year as Barack Obama.
Yeah. Now, did she go to college before going to law school?
Yes. She went. She got her BA. You know, they were still in high school when they were in the Runaways. So some of them got the GEDs. Some of them managed to finish on the road. I think some of them.
Wasn't that part of the deal that Kim made? You let your daughter come with me. I will be the great chaperone. I will see she gets her GE.
Yes, they were supposed to have tutors on the road. They were supposed to have chaperones, and they did. You know, there were road managers with them, but they were not great chaperones, and they never. Jackie remembers helping Sandy with her math.
Yeah.
so that was the tutoring, was them helping each other.
Well, that's not too bad either.
No, actually, it was good.
But they seemed disillusioned at the end.
Definitely. It was definitely a bitter falling out. As a matter of fact, it was so bitter and hard for them that I don't think any of them have fully recovered from the experience of having been in the Runaways and the experience of the breakup.
Interesting. Do any of them talk to Kim anymore?
They do. As a matter of fact, Kim and Lita and Cherie were in a studio together in Hollywood for the first time in 35 years, just a couple of weeks ago, and they wrote some songs together and recorded some songs.
Were you there?
I was not there.
Yeah.
No.
Oh,
I wish.
Yeah.
No, they did not. They didn't let me know ahead of time. So that's really great, and Cherie and Lita, and it was really, you know, it was a fight between Lita and Cherie that caused Cherie to leave the band. So for them to, they didn't speak to each other for years and years until very recently. And now they've been they did a song together and without Kim. They've been really supporting each other, so.
it was interesting how he wanted them to be like the Beatles, and just so different composition of the two troops.
Yeah. Yeah, you know, which is great. He wanted them to be the female Beatles or the female Rolling Stones or Led Zeppelin, which were, you know, I really give Kim credit for trying to have that vision, because Lord knows, to this day, we still need the female Beatles and the female Rolling Stones.
And what about David Bowie? He visited them when they were where? In Boston?
I'm pretty sure it was in Boston. And I believe that Iggy Pop was also at that show. Mm-hmm. There's so much mythology around the band and so many bad memories that sometimes I'm like, I believe that this is where, and there's enough stories tracing back to that, but people's memories of it are different.
And yet, looking at the cover, they were really attractive girls.
Yes, they owned their look. I mean, people, you know, nowadays it's no big deal, a girl in a corset on stage, you know.
Or the short shorts.
Right, or the very, very short shorts. But people gave them trouble for that. But they were teenage girls, and that's what teenage girls like to do, is look beautiful and show their bodies. So.
And a few of them also had parents who were in the film industry, never on the top level, but maybe C+.
Right. So, well, Kim's parents were both actors, and Cherie's mother was also an actor. Mm-hmm. And actually, I think they sort of had that bond. It was one of the few things they had in common.
Were they pleased with the film? Because there's one where two of the characters have been written out into one.
Well, those two characters are not very pleased with the movie. Apparently everybody was asked if they would participate, but they were not offered what they felt were sufficient funds, and they said no. So Joan Jett and Cherie Curry were Joan executive produced the movie, but even she wasn't that happy with it, to be honest. She felt like it was a little exploitive.
Have you heard from them about the book? Because I would say anybody who reads it will see how you went into depth about the family background, about their interplay, and what they were like as people.
Right, so I have talked to or emailed with pretty much all of them since it came out, not Lita. I think it's really hard to read something written about yourself, even if it's positive, especially if there's things that you didn't remember and didn't want to talk about or had repressed. So I think it's been hard. Like Joan told me that she started reading it and she had to put it down. Which is the same thing one of Sandy's sisters told me. Jackie has been really supportive, really liked it, said really nice things about it on Facebook. Kim has been really supportive.
How did you get them to talk? What were your questions to them that opened them up?
Well, you know, it started with, I originally wrote, it was actually my master's thesis. I was going to USC, and I wrote a thesis about Sandy West in particular, and that actually became a cover story in the LA Weekly. It was the journalism program at Annenberg. So it started, that was the seed for the book. And so, and they wanted to talk about Sandy because they wanted to honor Sandy because she had passed on and they really loved her. So that, I got to know the different players through having done that story. Yeah. So then when I decided to make it a book, I approached them again. And actually, Cherie would not talk to me again. She did not. I used the interview material from the previous two interviews I did with her. Lita was also very reluctant to speak. Jackie actually wouldn't talk to me for the Sandy West article, but gave me a couple really long sit-down interviews and several phone interviews.
Who is the one? Is it Carrie Cream?
Carrie Chrome.
Chrome. Who wouldn't let you use her last name?
Yeah, she didn't. She was the one. Well, you know, I didn't ask the others actually, but you know, she. I honored her request not to use her last name because she was really helpful to me, and I feel like there are some victims in this story, and Carrie was very, I would say, abused by Kim and in the band. And if she wanted to protect her identity and her personal life, I I respected that.
What was her role?
She was the lyricist, and in part, the band was her idea. So she was writing these songs. She had signed mm-hmm. a publishing deal with Kim. And she said, I want an all-girl band to perform them. And he said, that's a great idea. I've been wanting to form an all-girl band. You know, it was some meeting of good minds. And she said, well, she had met Joan Jett on a bus and then at some shows. And she said, well, I have a friend who plays guitar. And then Kim met Sandy West in the parking lot of the Rainbow Bar and Grill at like 2 in the morning or something, where rock stars and wannabes hung out. Yeah. And he put Joan and Sandy together.
Fascinating. Will you autograph my book?
Absolutely.
And if you'd like to know what else we've been reading, visit me on the web at www.ConnieMartinson, or visit us at YouTube, Connie Martinson's channel, and you can see the shows live, in a sense, as well as reading the columns. But support your local library. That is the best, as well as you can go in and get rock and roll discs that you can take out from the library and then bring them back. But support the library, and whatever you do, help them. They need it all, and we'll see you next time. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Connie. Thank you, Evelyn. It was a pleasure.